luistert naar de DCDW-podcast, gepresenteerd door Paul de Vries. Elke week praat Paul met interessante gasten over actuele online automotive onderwerpen. De DCDW-podcast wordt mede mogelijk gemaakt door nieuweautokopen.nl, Marktplaats, Marble, Autodata Nederland, You Name It en Bovemij.
Welkom op de DCDW-podcast van deze week met als gast Glenn Pesch. Glenn, de broer van, heb ik vandaag in de DCDW-podcast in Las Vegas bij de Digital Car Dealer Conference. Vandaar dat het een beetje hol klinkt, want we zitten nou eenmaal in een hele grote balzaal hier in Las Vegas in het hotel. Glenn, thank you for your visit here to the DCDW-podcast. Can you talk about more about Glenn Pesch?
Sure, thank you very much. Happy to be here. I'm a partner with my brother Brian, yeah. And so you've been friends with Brian for a long time. And we have an agency, and yeah. We do digital marketing for automotive dealers, but we also do a lot of education. Mm-hmm. We've written now, I think, 6 books for the automotive space on marketing, leadership, training, mm-hmm. Very practical hands-on books. Plus, we have online education, online classes. So we become an agency that not only can market, but help educate you and from a strategy standpoint. The final piece is we do a lot of writing for research. So we yeah. research products, we understand products, we receive a lot of phone calls, and you and I were talking today, yeah. You know, what is the new thing, or what should dealers be looking for, or mm-hmm. what products or services, what can they do so that they can sell more cars in this new business environment with online marketing?
Yeah, because you are talking a lot about the cost per engagement, zero engagement, etc. Because you have a lot of problems here in America with bot traffic. Huh?
Correct.
We don't have that much.
Right.
But here's a very big problem for the dealers?
It can be. I think before we started, you and I were talking about what could one thing that dealers need to understand. I think it's their data.
Yeah.
You know, it is not an easy thing for them to be comfortable with, because most dealers look at the metrics of how many did I sell, how many cars did yeah. I sell. But now when you're doing your marketing, especially online, it can be deceiving if you don't know, if your only metric is how many people came to my website. If that's your only metric, well, someone who may not have the best intentions could just sell you a marketing package that has technology or bots that mm-hmm. simulate traffic,
yeah.
but they're not really going down to a level that really indicates a true shopper's behavior, mm-hmm. meaning did they call you? Did they submit an online lead form? Did they chat with you? Did they text with you? Because I can just simulate traffic.
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter.
Is that really then the case that the only in KPI is a call lead, is a text lead, is a chat lead, is an email lead? Because how many people are coming in stealth?
Very good question. I think the metrics, the reports have been, and I don't think they've changed that much. The reports a few years ago were 70% of the people who came to your website would not do one of those 4 things. They would not call you. They would not submit a lead.
And 70% of the visitors or 70% of your sales?
No, 70% of the visitors to your website mm-hmm. would not contact you. They would just come in, right?
So to your after point, the research.
After the research. So mm-hmm. you have that, it's a combination. I come to your website, I look at what you're trying to sell me.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just the vehicle, it is who you are, how I do business with you, why I should contact you, right? So if I did a search for a brand or just for a dealer, and for some reason I clicked on your website, the question is, is the content there, what I see, going to keep you on my list of people to contact? If
yeah.
we agree that most customers are going to contact only one or two dealerships, maybe three. Mm-hmm. I know their statistics, 1.4. I always tell my dealers that if someone contacts you or they come in, you're either the first choice, so don't mess it up.
Yeah.
Or someone else messed it up and they're giving you the opportunity. But the days of going to four or five, six, seven dealerships are done. Yeah. So there are people who don't want to give you the information. One, because I can find a lot of information online.
Yeah.
I don't want to give you my name.
No.
Because I'm afraid you're going to do what you do.
Yeah.
You're going to contact me, call me multiple times. And should I, you know, do I want that? Am I ready for that right now?
Yeah. But so, that is fair, right? Because I think the 2017 consumer don't want to be transferred his data to anyone else when he only gets information what he can find anywhere.
True, true. I think that people are more comfortable now just giving their name if they need something, because yeah, we do name. That online, name or email, name and phone number.
Or fake email.
Whatever.
For that purpose.
Of course, but ultimately, I would say from what I see, you don't really get a large number of people faking it. If I'm already down the point where I do want to talk to you and I call you or I do put in my information.
I'm in market.
I need to understand. I have a question. And so that's where the engagement of us as salespeople or trying to buyers really connect versus someone who maybe is higher up in the funnel and you're offering them, well, here, download a brochure, which is very high level, but now all of a sudden I treat you the same as if someone said, I want information on that specific VIN vehicle where they're further down. So I think there is hesitation. I'd rather come in. I'm not sure about who you are, but as soon as they put in one of those four hard conversions, but again, that could be 30% of the people. That's still a good number of people. The key is the content on my website engaging them, telling the story of who we are as a dealership, besides just, hey, it's $199 or 199 euros or whatever it is. Here's your car. Here's a price that they see everywhere. What's going to be the difference of why I should do business with you?
And yesterday we had a keynote from Brian Benstock.
Right.
I thought it very interesting about Paragon Direct. What is your insight about it?
Well, I think he's trying to embrace the future. He sees that they're trying to collapse down this buying cycle. They want direct to consumer. How can I collapse it where there is as few steps, as many steps as I can achieve online to get it almost to the point of not even selling a car, fulfilling it, a fulfillment center. I ordered it, I picked it up. I think it's, as much as everybody still says online retailing and everything, that's the future, I still think there's a small pot of people that want that. They know, I want that car, I've driven that car, I don't need to test drive that car, I want this, or maybe I want to go all the way down and the last thing I'm going to do is just drive it to make sure everything's fine and I'm done. So I think I actually spoke with Brian after his keynote, and one of his comments was the automotive space over the next 5 years is going to go through a big transition, and a lot of people aren't prepared for it, meaning from the vendor side.
From the vendor side, as the CRM companies, you mean?
All of it, because what happens if, I mean, the consumers are going, want things quicker. You and I were talking, they find the information they want. What happens if Amazon gets into automobiles? Yeah. And all of a sudden, when you're logging in, you know, all of a sudden that there's no need for a CRM because you already did it and it communicates down, or they start saying, I'm going to be the middleman. Or what happens is they say, I want Paul's company to be the CRM for Amazon, and Amazon now all of a sudden all of the need for all of these other CRMs diminish.
Yeah.
Right. So that's what he was saying, is that the space is going to come to a point where some of these big players are going to say, well, automotive is a billion dollar industry.
Yeah. I need the growth.
well, what can I do to, why can't I go play in that field? I mean, Amazon just bought Whole Foods here, a big supermarket, to get into the food business of using their network. What would happen if Amazon went to GM and said, we will be your fulfillment centers for your vehicles, and we will host and we will interact and you can advertise, but we don't need that anymore.
Oh, we had in Holland few examples of OEMs to do private lease in supermarkets.
Right.
So why don't Amazon use Whole Foods to combine the automotive space with the supermarket?
Well, you see it in Walmart, where Walmart now has dentist offices and they have insurance. So what would be the same for them to say? I've seen it in traditional malls where a dealership will take over one of the stores and just put one car and kiosks and pictures and computers, and people go in and, oh, I'm here at the mall, I might as well look. I mean, we see cars in the mall just sitting in the middle, but there's no salespeople there.
No.
What if you had a salesperson there to say, let me tell you about this?
Yeah.
It's what some of the people are starting to understand is that at this conference, there's so many. It seems like there's so many vendors doing all these little things. I can do one little extra thing. I think it's going to collapse, where you're going to see more and more where the Cox Automotives are trying to give you an end-to-end solution all the way through, from websites to CRMs to DMS to online retailing, all of this suite, and they're going to eat that up. But what happens if a huge player decides to get in?
A really huge player.
Huge player, yeah, really huge, where all of a sudden they say, what happens if we were talking and brainstorming, what happens if Google... If you think of Google My Business, what if that became a website for you?
Yeah.
We don't need websites anymore, because if I could put my inventory feed in Google My Business with phone numbers and everything, and I can submit, I don't even need to see, it goes right in. I mean, when you start thinking that way.
It can happen, right? Because they are almost there in My Business.
Of course.
It is almost a website.
Of course it is almost a website.
On
now
the first
you have
page.
Offers, now you have videos, you have pictures. What if I could put my inventory feed into that?
No, but it is on the first page.
Of course.
Yeah, and that's really annoying when you see that the most dealers in Holland struggle to understand that their website is one of the platforms.
Mm-hmm.
You need also presence on Facebook, on Instagram, on LinkedIn, on whatever the case will be. Your website is not the only place people visit.
Exactly. So you and I are both, we both like Gary Vaynerchuk.
Mm-hmm.
I have a lot of respect for him. And one of his things that he always says, and it is true marketing, it's where are the eyeballs?
Yeah.
Right? So you can't discount. You may not like it, but the days, to your point of, I have a website, I'm done. Well, that was fine 10 years ago when Facebook didn't exist and all of these other platforms didn't exist and all you had was Google or Yahoo at that time.
As the remote control to go there.
And went there, and everything was housed there. Now, all of a sudden, I have to have a presence on Facebook, or I have, and it's, you don't have to.
No.
You just have to understand is, that's where people are looking.
Yeah.
So you have to make a decision of, do I want to advertise? Is it cost effective to advertise to those people on that platform? Because that's where they are. So you don't have to, but then you can't have it the other way and complain that I'm not selling, and or I want to continue to do what I've been doing for the last 10 years when eyeballs have gone down.
Autodata Nederland. Beter taxeren, inkopen en verkopen? Dat krijg je voor elkaar met Autodata. Eigentijdse applicaties voor automotive professionals. Kijk voor meer info op www.autodata.nl. LEF, het lead management systeem van You Name It, waarbij al uw leads in één systeem kunnen worden opgevolgd, helpt u op weg van lead naar deal. LEF is vernieuwend, verrassend en compleet. Door haar koppelingen met vele automotive leadbronnen en het eenvoudige management dashboard heeft u real-time inzicht in uw volledige leadproces. Uw leadproces volledig onder controle? Kijk dan op datislefhebben.nl. Marble Digital Marketing Solutions is het online marketingbureau voor de autobranche. Wij bouwen data-driven websites op een platform dat volledig is geoptimaliseerd voor gebruik binnen de autobranche. Door vele koppelingen zijn wij in staat om een naadloze integratie van online naar offline te realiseren voor u en uw klanten. Een hogere conversie via uw eigen website? Voorzien van geavanceerde techniek en functionaliteiten? Tegen een vaste fee per maand zonder hoge eenmalige investeringen? Dan bent u bij Marble aan het juiste adres. www.marble.nl. Wij helpen bedrijven in de mobiliteitsbranche bij al hun verzekeringen, financieringen en rechtshulp. Onze missie? Onze klanten nog succesvoller laten ondernemen. Als onderdeel van BOVAG bestaan wij voor en door de mobiliteitsbranche. Anders dan andere partijen vinden wij het dan ook belangrijk om de branche sterk te houden. BOVEMEI. Samen vooruit.
But is that the same discussion dealers have in Holland, but also in America, about the love and hate affair with portals? The eyeballs? They have the eyeballs?
Yeah, I think because I don't think it's a combination. I don't think the dealers have sat down enough with the portals to fully understand what that portal is going to do for you.
The portals lack the education to the dealers.
Exactly. The portals have done a horrible job communicating their value to them. And again, it's, you know, dealers want leads. So in the beginning, I'll give you leads. Yeah. But really, that may or may not be getting leads. The value might be just I'm showing your inventory. I'm an advertiser. Look at how many vehicles they're looking at. Because again, the promise of digital marketing in the beginning was always we could see everything and measure everything. And we can't. We're moving towards that now with multi-channel funnels to see that a portal assisted getting someone to my website assisted versus a direct lead form or a direct phone call. But when we've done our research and done surveys and asked shoppers in America, how do you shop? Where do you go when you look for a used car? The first place they go are the portals. Yeah. When you go for a new car, manufacturer, then the portals, then the individual websites. Right? So again, you may not like the portal, or you might have to go find a portal that you like, but to say I'm not going to be on the portals when 60% of the people, 70% of the people who say I'm shopping for a used vehicle go to the portals.
Yeah.
That just doesn't make any sense to me. So again, doesn't mean you have to be on all of them. That doesn't mean you have to be on this one or this one. You have to have the conversation. The dealer has to take the responsibility to sit with that vendor and fully understand and get them to speak to them in language they understand to say, if I give you this money, what do I get? How does your tool work? How is my inventory seen? What happens if someone submits a lead? Do I get it? Does someone else get it? How does it work? So that you then can be comfortable with that. And then you monitor the investment. Again, it's another form of advertising. And are you seeing people work? Meaning they're ringing the phone, they're walking in. And when you ask them, how did you find us? Right? And like you were saying, you give them a list of the logos and say, what did you see? And someone's going to say, I can't remember the name, but that's the logo. Yeah. I went to that website.
Yeah.
Right.
And the inventory is not there.
Or they even say it was there. That's why I'm here, because I went to that website and it worked. So then you can say, it's working. Yeah. Right. But I think this touches on a bigger point that one thing that dealers need to be doing more of is getting educated on this. It doesn't mean, and there's a different friction because certain individuals in the dealership, be it the dealer principal, the manager, whatever, they look at digital marketing and say, well, I have to be able to do it. And we're saying, no, you don't have to be able to log into analytics and really set up goals and do all of these or create a Facebook ad.
Yeah.
But you have to understand enough of it to be able to, at a level that you can have a conversation with a vendor to say, what am I getting for the money? Why should I advertise? Yeah. Where do I advertise with that? Because you do that Most do it very comfortably with their traditional, what they've been doing for a long time. They have that conversation with, if it's television, when does it play? Radio, when does it play? I have an in the newspaper, when do I see it? And I know how to build it out. They just stopped because part digital marketing can see complex with a computer.
Yeah.
Vendors have done a horrible job of educating dealers. They like to keep them a little bit in the dark.
I think the last one, if I see the lack of education from the vendor side in Holland, from the vendor side, that they are not comfortable to let the dealers see the whole picture. Because the dealer doesn't understand it, doesn't ask the questions. So they are saying, hey, I get no questions. No, because they are not understanding it.
Well, dealers said to me, I ask dealers all the time. And the dealers say to me, well, Glenn, I don't know what questions to ask. And I don't know who to trust.
Yeah.
Right? But that's what I said. Well, then you're thinking you have to ask a complex question. And they said, I don't understand what that means. I said, you think you have to ask something like, using the terminology of digital marketing.
UTM tags or whatever.
Versus very simple. So the point of
you... What should be the five simple questions you can...
So if you sat there and
top
said...
Top of your mind.
Okay. So if I pay someone to do paid search.
Yeah.
Right? Someone paid search. First I would say is, what are we advertising? Very simple.
Which inventory?
Yeah. Well, whatever. If I'm... Well, they're going to advertise new cars. What does that mean? See, that's the best question to keep asking is, what does that mean? Well, that means we take your top vehicles and advertise them. What does that mean? Which cars? How do you decide? What's going on, right? So, same thing with used. It's vehicle specific. Is it general terms of? So again, when you start asking simple questions of, well, how do they find us? Well, we advertise on keywords. What do keywords mean? Well, those are the things that you type in when you're looking for something. Oh, okay. So how do we decide what those are? Well, we look at, see, all of those things. So I would be saying, what campaigns? I'm giving you this money. How are you advertising? What are you advertising? When they click on the ad, meaning how do you decide? Who writes the ads? Oh, we do. Great. Can I see them? Right? What are you writing? Now, then where do we send them? So if I click on the ad, where do I go?
Yeah.
Like those are very simple things that you can ask every single month, because if an ad doesn't work, maybe I sent them to the wrong place.
Yeah, because the same discussion we had is that you did an investigation, an survey, that you actually saw that a lot of AdWords campaign landed on the new car page of the used car page, but actually the leads coming from that page were after service,
yes.
Of service leads.
Yes. Yes. So what we found is in certain types of campaigns, when you start looking at the data, and again, dealer principals who are, I don't want to hear, I have to look at the data, but you can ask. I spent $5,000 advertising new cars. I got 200 phone calls.
Yeah.
Then I need to talk to whoever's doing my call tracking to say, okay, so my marketer said I got 200 phone calls.
How many?
Who's my who handles my phone calls? And you go over and say, hey, we got 200 phone calls this month. How many were for sales? How many were for service? And if they say, well, 50 were for sales, 150 were for service or after service, after market, I go back to my marketer and say, yes, you sent me phone calls, but why aren't they for cars? Yeah. Why are they calling for service? What can we do to maybe adjust something where I still get the
service
for after service, but more of my money goes to new? See, so again, it's not complex if you just ask the right questions of saying, what are you spending it on? Where are they going? In other words, where are you sending them on my website? How do we know it works? And how are you explaining it to me in language I understand, which means...
The language I understand.
Well, that's what I always say to them. If I don't understand, don't be afraid to say, I don't know what that means. Get them to explain it in a way...
In normal language.
In normal language. And then you go, oh, that's what that means.
Yeah.
Oh, so when they click, When you say they click to my website, oh, so we land them here. Right, great. Well, what did they do here? Well, what did we ask them to do? Well, yeah. Let's look. It could be that, yes, I'm sending you interested people, but I didn't ask them to do anything.
Yeah. But is then, because we introduce call tracking in Holland,
right,
with the call morning to listen to the calls,
exactly,
also.
Yeah.
What is the biggest advantage for dealers to do that? Because you have here a lot of experience for years now to listen to the calls.
It's training to, if you go backwards to start at the beginning and say, here's the reason why you should do business with Paul's dealership, mm-hmm, your dealership. We do this and that we want our people to take care of our customers, answer their questions, you know, give them the information that they want. Well, the only way that I'm going to know, you're sitting over at your desk making phone calls. The only way I know if you're doing what I need you to do to reinforce the experience at my dealership, the happy dealership, we take care of everybody. The only way I can find out of that is if, the only way I can find out about that is listening to the phone call. And then I have what my expectations were. So I have a list to help that person get better. Did you answer the phone correctly? Did you identify yourself? Did you listen to them? Did you give them the answer that they were looking for? Were you pleasant? Did you schedule an appointment? Whatever you're looking for them to do, the only way that you can find out is listening to the call or having a company do it and giving you a report that says, Glenn took 50 phone calls, took them or made them, and he did well on these three things, but he doesn't ask for the appointment.
Yeah, and it's ask for the appointment, because that is the thing you hear 24/7, make right, the appointment, make the appointment. And when I'm listening to the calls in Holland, people ask for availability. Is right, the car still available? Yes. So, great, I'm coming Saturday. But no appointment is ever made. The customer is coming. Is that wrong?
Yes. I personally think, again, you want to, for me, I would like to be prepared for that person.
Yeah.
So I would say if you said, well, I'm coming in on Saturday, great. Are you coming in the morning or the afternoon? See, here it gets a little technical of, well, what's the best time? One or two? Two or five? Right. But if I said to you, you're going to come in the morning or the afternoon, well, I'll be in the morning. Okay, do you have any idea about what time you'll be here? Because I want to be prepared. And they'll say, well, somewhere around 10, between 10 and 11. Perfect. Great. When you come in, ask for Glenn. And then I have the car ready for when you come in. I'm ready for you. If not, the potential is that the assumption of the customer is, well, I told you I was coming in. Why aren't you ready for me? So that experience then can have a little friction.
Yeah.
Where it's not in their mind, well, I told them I was coming. Why aren't they ready? Versus, well, let me be ready for you. So let me just confirm. So you'll be here somewhere between 10 and 11. This is the vehicle. So when you come in, it'll be ready. I just bring your license or whatever so that if you're going to, we'll take a drive. You just have to have that for you. And great, I look forward to seeing you. And then confirm. We confirm, and confirming appointments, restaurants confirm, hotel, I want to make sure you're coming tomorrow. Great. Oh, yeah, I'll be in. Oh, something came up. Great. Let me reschedule you. I think it's easy to just get excited when someone says, I'll be in. But I really think the more that you can have some framework, I, as a salesperson, I, as the person in the store, can then prepare to continue to have this great experience.
Yeah. And the management knows what happened, right?
Exactly.
Because the online leads, they can track, but when they don't track the call leads and appointments, everything is coincidence, what happened.
Right, because then what happens is you never, to your point, you never have enough detail, because then if the sales didn't buy, you know, I'm not selling enough, well, they never showed up. Even if they showed up, they didn't show up because they could come in and I...
But management doesn't know.
Of course, but that's what I'm saying. The more that you can track phone calls, the more that you can listen to calls to make your team better. I equate it always to sports. So soccer, mm-hmm. Holland, very, very important, right? Very big. Yeah. So if you thought at on any weekend, whenever the next game is, if the coaches weren't on the sideline, you would say, where are the coaches? And the coaches said, oh, they're professionals. They know what they're supposed to do. You'd say, fire that coach. Or if the coaches never practiced, if they just paid the people and they showed up on a certain day and you hope they practiced on their own, you'd have a horrible team.
Yeah.
But we don't run a dealership like with the same idea of running a sports team, where I think the manager is a coach. And if you stop saying manager and you say, I'm a coach of my sales team, I'm a coach of these, then you actually get out and watch what they're doing, listen to what they're doing, listen to their calls, just like sports teams watch video.
Yeah.
See where you were over here, you weren't here, you didn't do this, did this. Same thing with phone call. This was good, this wasn't good, this, even looking at their email response.
And that is not negative, right?
No.
You make it better.
It all depends how you position it. If it's positioned as I'm managing you,
yeah,
and I'm listening to you to find fault, so I can scream at you,
yeah,
then it's negative. But if I tell them I'm coaching you to get better, I'm coaching you to make more money, I'm coaching you for all of us, right? But yes, there's going to be times where as a coach, you're going to say, we've talked about this three or four times. But if it's always done that I'm listening in and you always say, look at all the great things you're doing, here's things we're working on, and I'm there helping you do it, not just saying, Paul, fix this. No, my job to coach is, let me help you get better.
Yeah.
Then it all can be positive, and actually they like that, because where else can you get coaching all the time to make you better?
Of course.
Right? So that, to me, is something that even here I talk about a lot.
A lot.
Because they just don't think that they're coaches. They think that, well, salespeople should just learn this on their own, or they should do this. And I say, well, that's not a best practice if you want to be a winning organization.
No.
You need coaching. You need training.
It's too much coincidence then.
Yeah. Because, well, you can't repeat behavior.
No.
Because one month it works, but I don't know why it worked. I can't repeat that behavior and do it again.
Yeah.
Versus someone who says, this is our playbook.
Yeah.
Here's how we greet customers. Here's how we answer the phone. That's a playbook, just like running a football play.
Yeah.
Right? You know?
Do the basics extremely well.
Exactly. And the same thing, when you're looking at the video, you didn't pass back here. We know on this play, when we're going to shoot on goal, we pass, then shoot. You didn't do that. Same thing. When the phone call rang, you went here, you didn't answer what they were supposed to say. You didn't answer their question. You didn't ask for the appointment. That's not part of our playbook. We need to go back and practice that. So the next time you play for real with a customer, you're putting yourself in a position to be more successful.
Great. Glenn, one more thing. What thing do you want to share with the Dutch audience about you, about online automotive, about what they can be useful?
I think that the biggest thing to remind yourself is that this online world is not going away, right? It's going more eyeballs in more places. You have to decide what you can do. So my recommendation always is, I would rather you do one thing well, right? So if you say, I have my website and Facebook, right? Instead of doing Facebook and Twitter and Snapchat and portals and everything, you say, my website's going to be great. My Google My Business will be great. I'm going to understand portals and I'm going to learn about Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
And then once I'm done with that and I feel comfortable, then you can say, I can add on something else. So I would say, do what you're comfortable doing. Make sure you manage it really, really well. Bless you, Paul. Really, really well. And make sure that you're not trying to do too many things, because then you won't get anything accomplished.
Okay. Glenn, thank you. Thank you for the podcast. Thank you for this interview. Very helpful. And of course, thank you for all you did for me and for anybody else, of course.
I appreciate that. Thank you so much, Paul.
Okay, thank you.
Right. Bedankt voor het luisteren naar Digital Car Dealer Workshop, de podcast. Volgende week is er weer een nieuwe uitzending met wederom een interessante gast en boeiende onderwerpen. Kijk voor meer informatie en de notes van deze uitzending op www.dcdw.nl/podcast. En wilt u meer weten over DCDW? Kijkt u dan op dcdw.nl. De DCDW-podcast wordt mede mogelijk gemaakt door nieuweautokopen.nl, Marktplaats, Marble, Autodata Nederland, you name it, en Bovee Mij.